Hey guys, before we get started today, I'm very excited to say that this video is sponsored by NordVPN. Yes, you heard that right, the starry-eyed, fully grown 22-year-old who made this channel in the summer of 2019 never thought he'd make it this far. For those of you who aren't aware, VPN stands for Virtual Private Network. You can essentially consider it like a big virtual shield. VPNs allow you to safely and discreetly explore the internet, hiding your IP address and masking your location, keeping your browsing activity and data out of reach and out of sight from any and everyone. The only time I like to be watched is when I'm making a YouTube video. Otherwise, leave me alone, don't look at me. NordVPN's like having a big bodyguard. No government agency's gonna make direct eye contact with you when this guy's behind you. And the reality is, everything we do online can be bought and sold, and we're not always 100% protected, even when we're just browsing social media from the comfort of our own homes. A virtual private network like NordVPN uses encryption to keep internet service providers and hackers from getting their hands on your data and doing whatever they please with it. And if you're here, I find it pretty likely that you're into gaming, and a VPN can go a long way in enhancing your experience, protecting you from pesky content restrictions and bandwidth throttling. NordVPN is one of the best in the business, winning all sorts of awards and consistently being recommended by top technology experts. They've got over 5,500 ultra-fast servers across 60 countries, 24/7 customer support, and can help you lift restrictions on content that's blocked for you depending on where you live, like Netflix. So if you're so inclined, head on over to nordvpn.com/regularpat or use the code regularpat to get a 2-year plan plus one additional month with a hearty discount. So don't be like a certain rat we know. Protect your data, protect yourself, and check out NordVPN. To be honest, it'd be a big win for all of us. We've analyzed some pretty big topics on this channel, like the best cinematic moments in the series, the evolution of motion throughout the games, and we've even tackled the student loan crisis and the minimum wage. Wait, you don't remember that? Yeah, that was last year. You were asleep. But today I want to go smaller picture. I've ranked the games, and games are made up of worlds. I've ranked worlds, and the worlds are made up of rooms. That's right, we're getting increasingly granular. In 2022, I'll be covering my favorite pixel on each Keyblade. But I'm a big fan of rooms. Video games make architecture and geography so simple. If it's got a loading zone on one or more sides of it, it's a room. You don't necessarily need walls, a floor, or a ceiling, just some text when you pause the game saying, here's the place you're in. So we're gonna stomp down in every iteration of each world in Kingdom Hearts and pick out what I think is the best room. Best is, of course, a short and convenient word I'm using to substitute for a long explanation of my personal opinions on a room's physical layout, visual design, and contextual moments associated with it. But that makes for a bad YouTube video title. Those aspects are probably weighed sequentially heavier for me when judging level design, but it's definitely a mixture of all of those elements. Also, by every Kingdom Hearts world, I mean everything besides Days Encoded, because I don't want to. You can do those ones if you want. Me, I'm gonna take a walk through KH1 and 2 today, and in part 2 we'll go through Birth by Sleep, Dream Drop, and KH3. So, let's get started. Kicking off our journey is the first room that doesn't take place in a metaphysical acid trip nightmare. It's the seashore in Destiny Islands. While the cove is potentially the more physically interesting half of the world, the seashore also has some neat layered elements to it, on top of being one of the most iconic areas in the series. So much has happened and will happen here. Xehanort stood on these shores, and Ansem's gonna stand here later. Kairi's gonna write her message in a bottle here and send it off from this shore, and nearly the entire cast of heroes will reunite here at the end of KH3. The end of each main game brings us back here in one way or another, and it's always a welcome sight. Things did used to be so much simpler, from collecting logs and fish to doing that. Although Trapper's Town in KH1 is one of my absolute favorite worlds in the series, and it's got so many memorable rooms, my pick for favorite area here was pretty immediately a no-brainer. It's the First District. I've built mansions in The Sims, lived in humble dirt shacks and massive sky towers in Minecraft, I've even crashed in my fair share of GTA apartments, but they all pale in comparison to the First District when it comes to imparting that feeling of hominess. Maybe this room just beats you down with its persistence given how often you'll be returning here, but I like that about it. You'll be back here to put out some candles, run some errands for a wizard, visit a strange old man and his puppet baby, and do while you're Christmas shopping here. All the while, the music and the atmosphere just makes it feel like a big warm blanket. And so the shadows briefly invading the room on the first visit makes me feel deeply, deeply uncomfortable. It sullies the safety and sanctity of the First District. It's like taking a big poop in church. I've never really gone to church, but I have to imagine that they don't want you doing that. This is totally a cheat, but Wonderland's best room is the Bazaar room for sure. Even without taking its different forms into account, just the basic right-side-up version of the room is more interesting than everything else the world has to offer. Wonderland's hottest club is the Bazaar room. This place has it all. Strange shrinking liquids, talking doorknobs, a teddy bear that you can toss around for your amusement. Ironically, despite the name, the basic form of the Bazaar room is actually one of the most normal places Sora visits in the first game. It's pretty much just a pseudo-modern, albeit poorly decorated kitchen. But you can turn it upside down and left side right and find all sorts of secrets and hidden pathways from one area to another. The Bazaar room is definitely the setting for many of my what the hell I had no idea about that moments in my later playthroughs of KH1. So not a ton of options in Olympus Coliseum, but I think by default the most interesting room is the first one you see here, the Coliseum Gates. It's the biggest one and the only one with any actual treasure to collect. There's also just a sort of majesty and grandiosity to it, especially that first time you walk in. Look at those big golden Chad statues. Did you know that before you do the Trinities here, the chests that they cause to drop down are just hanging out on their shoulders? Take that useless fact home and put it in the bank. Or, I don't know why you would take it home if you're gonna put it in the bank later. I guess, take it right to the bank. Like the seashore, there's also a lot of history and history in the making here. It's one of the few locations that Sora, Roxas, and all three Wayfinders have been to in their travels. It's also really cool having the new leaderboards pop up with each tournament that's unlocked, so you can keep a nice, tidy list of the destruction you leave in your wake. The two major movie set pieces in Deep Jungle are the camp and the treehouse, and while the former is probably more iconic, the treehouse is also one of the most recognizable places from the movie, and it's physically much more interesting. It'll probably become apparent as we make our way through each world that I really like when rooms have some verticality to them, and the treehouse is the first real example of that. You literally never have to go any higher than the surface where you first fight Sabor when you show up, but you can, and I like that. The only thing up there is like a protect chain or something, but damn does the game make you work for it. Plus you've got treasures tucked away in that netting portion underneath and one out in the suspended boat. It's just a fun room to climb around and explore, especially for freaks of nature who enjoy KH1 platforming like myself. I also always thought it was really cool how in the final mix version they added some dried blood from Tarzan's parents on the floor. For Agrabah, I really wanted to pick Aladdin's house because there's just something so idealistically romantic about living rent-free in someone's dry rot laden attic with your pet monkey and sentient carpet, but it's definitely more style than substance. I ended up changing my mind to the Fall in the Cave of Wonders, which is one of the more intimidating looking rooms in the game, even if it's not actually that difficult to progress through. But it's got spitting statues, Indiana Jones boulders, floating pillars, and a sea of darkness. It's everything that the Cave of Wonders should be, and it's always a shame to look at this in comparison to how it's portrayed in KH2. In the sequel, it's just kind of a straight shot with these hyper-structured sequences and challenges. I think the cave should be a trap-infested, spooky gauntlet of a dungeon, and this room epitomizes that feeling for me. I've sang the praises of this room before, but the mouth in Monstro is so good. It doesn't exactly have the toughest competition, considering the rest of the world is a disgusting sequence of squelchy intestinal cavities, but even still, this is one of the coolest rooms in the game. Immediately sets the tone, immediately makes you jealous that the whale floating around outer space has nicer teeth than you do. I just like how it's conceptually gross, but the execution somehow makes it feel cozy. Like, ignoring that the stench is probably vile and that the water here is likely riddled with disease, it just seems like a chill place to hang out. On top of that, there's some platforming to do to get some chests here, and the room actually changes halfway through when you lower the water level, which we love. So like, Game of Inches when it comes to Atlantica, I guess. For me, when I think of the world, most of it blends together as just these blue ocean spaces that I guess might be geographically interesting if I squint and tilt my head, but none of it is particularly memorable. The more memorable rooms are pulled from the movie, like Ariel's Grotto, but it's pretty small and basically just an underwater loot box. So I'm going with the Sunken Ship for Atlantica because I dig the spooky atmosphere and the frankly terrifying mini-boss fight against the shark that takes place here. I'm always a sucker for abandoned buildings and relics and stuff like that, so a room with a big shipwreck laying around is right up my alley. There's also some legitimately well-hidden treasures here, which, again, we love. Pound for pound, Halloween Town may have the most fun rooms to explore out of all the Disney worlds in the game. But for those of you who have listened to my commentary on KH1 before, it'll come as no surprise that I fucking love Oogie's Manor. And I understand it's probably a polarizing location, especially for those who don't really enjoy the platforming stuff or dislike the boss fight with the dark orbs, but I just think it's neat. It's so weird and structurally complex compared to most stuff in especially the series, but even in KH1. You could give me the name of any room in the game and I could probably draw up a map of the general layout, but the manor is so massive and twisty and turny that I wouldn't even know where to start. It's just an area where you can really feel the sense of scale, which is something I think the series struggled with after KH1. And again, it's another example of what I think is really fun vertical level design, as admittedly frustrating as it can feel to get knocked off and have to climb back up to the top. And for those of you who really dislike it, you can just kill Oogie Boogie and turn the manor into a KH2 room. I guess it might speak pretty poorly of the rest of the world to pick the only room outside of the pirate ship as the best one, but is it really any contest when the clock tower is in play? The deck of the pirate ship is cool, and it is where you first gain the ability to freely fly in the world, but I know I would always return to the clock tower and fly around in it after I completed Neverland. And sure, it's technically London and not Neverland, but Kingdom Hearts really isn't the place to argue semantics. In addition to allowing me to jump to my death and then take it back, this room also serves as one of the best boss arenas in the game, in my opinion. Very rarely does the environment work in tandem with a boss fight in KH1 as the clock tower does with the Phantom. And plus it gets its own field theme. Shimomura really composed a track for just this one room, which in fairness would not have meshed well at all with Captain Hook's pirate ship, but I'm just glad they went the extra mile here. It fully captures how fun and god diddly damn cool it is to fly around an iconic British monument with Donald Duck and Peter Pan in tow. Hey, I bet you forgot this world was a thing. Despite straying away from the combat side of things, 100 Acre Wood does in fact have rooms. Most of them are pleasant enough, but basic, like most of the people I went to college with. But the standout for me is the Bouncing Spot, which is the most fun to explore and is the name of Tigger's underground nightclub. It's been long established that I don't really lose my mind over any of the 100 Acre Wood minigames in KH1, but the giant pot game and the tree stump flavored rendition of Simon are definitely some of the more tolerable diversions. I also like that there's additional stuff to do here besides the minigame. Little platformy puzzly things are predictably always a big hit with me. It's also the only room in the series that houses rare nuts, so are you really gonna argue with me on this? Oh look, it's the entire reason I wanted to make this video. I love the library in Hollow Bastion, like perhaps beyond reason. It's my favorite room in the series. Okay, so if I could like jump into any Kingdom Hearts game and just take everything in for an hour or a day or whatever, I'm blue skidooing right into the HB library. Now I'm not really a book guy, but think about how much lore there is on these shelves. I mean, I'm sure some of it is probably some lame romantic era fiction, but I bet it's an absolute treasure trove of light, dark heart knowledge. If Hollow Bastion is one of the few worlds in the series we can truly consider important, I would have to think that its library is filled with some pretty consequential material. If Aerith found some Ansem reports scattered around in here, who knows what else is lying around? What other authors line these bookcases? Do you think Lushu or the Master of Masters have ever popped in here and perused the shelves? Speaking of which, why aren't all of the books named after the Foretellers? They should have retconned that in the remix, I would have been totally fine with it. Or they should have named the actual characters after the books. Foreteller, Saleg, and Hafit. Alright, maybe not that. But on top of all the lore stuff, this place is just cozy. I want to take a nap here while Kairi's impossibly old grandmother tells me a rambling story about how mega potions used to cost 5 money at the general store. And it has a puzzle that feels satisfying but isn't actually difficult at all, my favorite. And there are these weird spinny things with a chest inside them. Is it actually annoying? Yeah, don't make me come up with some way to defend it, it sucks. And the crown jewel here is the inclusion of what I call HBPS, Hidden Bookshelf Passage Shit, the coolest thing ever conceived by man, woman, or anthropomorphic duck. It's the best room. It's the best room. End of the world as a whole is just pure insanity, like the people who designed most of the textures here need to be locked up. Whoever made the giant crevasse needs a series of hugs, and I really wanted to go with that room because a big, vertical, gummy ship graveyard is really, really cool, but I ended up going with the laboratory room in the world terminus. It's really just a hallway with a bunch of cigarette burn marks with the machine off to the side in a square room, but the lore implications back then, and especially now, definitely heighten my intrigue when it comes to this place. I'm also, if you couldn't tell, a sucker for KH1 Hollow Bastion, so getting just one more morsel of it before the game ended was a treat. But as I mentioned, the main attraction here is the machine, which is mainly just spouting a bunch of mumbo jumbo, but it also drops the big K and H on you, which just felt foreboding and sort of unexpected on my first playthrough. I genuinely was not expecting Kingdom Hearts to be an actual entity in the game. It'd be like if Tidus was about to fight the final boss of FF10 and he said, "This is my Final Fantasy." It just doesn't seem right. It didn't seem right at the time, and it still kind of doesn't. And that's what End of the World is all about, a constant sense of things not seeming right. Do we really need to move on to KH2 already? Can't we stop down at, like, Recom? What do you mean there's not really new stuff in Recom? You got White Room, and White Room with Big Door. Oh, you know what? This one's easy. My favorite new room in Recom is Riku's dorm room from Reverse Rebirth. You remember Riku's dorm room, right? Maleficent rents it out to him during the Hollow Bastion floor. I guess it's implied that this is where he stayed during KH1, but we only get to experience its full glory in Chain of Memories. What a great room. Reminds me of the library. Alright, so I've made it no secret that I'm not a huge fan of KH2 level design. I've made enough snide comments here already, so I won't go into a big speech about what I think it lacks and why I prefer the other games when it comes to pure physical layout. You can look around the channel if you really want to hear me complain at length. But thankfully, we're starting out with two worlds that I think are at the top of the pile when it comes to level design. Twilight Town is my favorite world in the game due to its tendency to feel like it might actually be a lived-in community, and a lot of rooms here help contribute to that feeling. I ended up going with the Sunset Terrace, which is maybe not what you first think of when you hear Twilight Town, but it's sort of like the end of the world machine where I was really surprised by its existence. I was like, oh shit, a whole second half of the town. When were you gonna tell me about this, Pence? In addition, it's also the host of a handful of the Seven Wonders, which I always thought was a charming little diversion. It's also the home to the hardest to get chest in base KH2. Alright, I'm done. Much like my incessant fist-shaking at KH2 level design, I'm also on the record for incessantly praising the Cavern of Remembrance, so it should come as no surprise that my favorite room in KH2 Radiant Garden is gonna come from there. There's something cool about each of the rooms in the cavern, but I went with the mining area, because of course I did. I'm a whore for platforming, and this room is chock full of it. Moving blocks, wind gusts to ride on, and treasure chests tucked away in unconventional spots. I also enjoy the implication that Radiant Garden was like this mining community, like Sid and Leon's grandpas were definitely co-workers in the cavern crystal mines back in the day. And again, we've got vertical level design fine here. I know you can always run the risk of falling down and having to climb back up, but I've always found progression upwards more satisfying than progression from left to right. Does that make sense? Is that indicative of a deeper meaning, or do I just have a weird ape brain? I don't think those two are mutually exclusive. So here's where we hit a bit of a dry spell, in my opinion. Land of Dragons is exceedingly bland, but it's also not like Mulan is necessarily full of stunning imagery or geographic standouts. I ended up going with the throne room because, I don't know, the colors are neat and the Emperor's here, and he's a cool guy. He was voiced by a guy named Pat, so that's pretty rad. They got these bird statues, a lot of treasure chests. Look, what was I supposed to go with here? The mountain trail? It's brown rocks. I'm doing my best. I find Beast Castle to be a bit more physically interesting than Land of Dragons, but there aren't really any singular rooms that stand out for me. Upon some examination, I settled on the ballroom, which is by far the most iconic area from the source material and is at least visually interesting. And sure, it's just a flat oval room, but it does have some fun interplay with the Darkthorn boss fight, how it possesses different facets of the room to attack you. Like, I bet you didn't expect to be fighting the big ornate chandelier from Beauty and the Beast when you turned on KH2 for the first time. And while we're looking up, I never noticed this Michelangelo-looking shit on the ceiling here. Looks like these angel babies are engaged in some kind of cloud-based warfare. I'm sure we'll get a phone game about it at some point. Again, I like Olympus and KH2 more than both Disney worlds we've covered in this game so far, but the underworld is probably a better hole than any of its standalone parts. A lot of sort of indistinguishable, foggy caves, so we basically need to pick our favorite of those. I ended up going with the one called the Lost Road, which is one of the less straightforward rooms in the world and the game, given its twisty, turny nature. It's also got these friendly falling concussion boulders and a bunch of lucky emblems. Honorable mention to the Valley of the Dead, which is pretty by the books on the way up, but a lot cooler on the way down during the Hades chase sequence. It's also green instead of gray, so that's different. KH2's Disney Castle primarily borrows from rooms seen in the KH1 cutscenes besides the Hall of the Cornerstone. I ended up going with the Courtyard, the only room in the series with trumpeting pigs, which you can't really argue against. I assume these hedge statues are depicting the in-universe orchestra responsible for the Michael Mouse Club March, which will no doubt infest your brain and soul if you spend more than 10 seconds here. I also like that you can actually see the colonnade from this room and vice versa. It makes the world feel more real. It's also the site of the iconic moment where Donald wakes up his friend by electrocuting him. What the fuck? Timeless River is another world where the whole experience is stronger than any one particular room because they're all pretty small and generic, especially the stuff outside the time travel windows. So I narrowed my picks down to those four windows, which are, again, not all that complex. I decided on Michael's house because it does at least have some interesting decor to look at. Like, look, he has a Christmas tree and he killed a moose one time. And it's snowing outside. It's truly interesting to get an insider's perspective on how the rat lived before he became royalty. I looked all over to find the pieces of chopped up people that he definitely has here somewhere, but I had no luck. All he has in his closet is an interdimensional portal to a burning building, which is honestly also suspicious. There's also some fun imagery of a Christmas-decorated living room being disrupted by a black hole, so points for that, I guess. Oh man, are we really doing this? I'm nothing if not thorough, I suppose. Well, of the two playable rooms in this world, I guess we're going with the Undersea Courtyard, which to its credit is more visually interesting than any one of the rooms in KH1 Atlantica, what with the underwater flora. I could technically cheat and pick any of the rooms where you're playing a song since they are playable locations, but on second thought, any room where I'm not participating in a musical is going to have a leg up, or a fin up, on the competition. Also, the only other real room is this bland-ass throne room with King Triton floating around in it, and he's frankly a dick, so no real contest here. Oh boy, Port Royal, what a visually stunning locale. I guess I'll go with the Seadrift Keep and Ship Graveyard, kind of along the same line of logic as the sunken ship in KH1 Atlantica. It's got an upper and lower level, and to be honest, most of the points here come from being able to hit this anchor thing. Like, I kind of forgot how it felt to be able to interact with the environment. And I guess you can technically consider this an example of the world changing as you progress through it, since this is literally the Interceptor, but destroyed. Remember all the good times we had on the Interceptor? I mean, I don't. I was asking you. Yeah, so again, I'm on record not being a huge fan of what they do to both Agrabah proper and the Cave of Wonders in KH2, since they're both pretty much stripped of their complexity, especially the latter. So I'm going rogue with this one. Expanding off of my abandoned ruin fetish, I'm picking the Sandswept Ruins, the only room in the game where Sora is glued to an expensive rug. Is it particularly interesting to explore? Did I kind of forget it existed until I started this project? No and yes in that order, but it's different, and it's not like there's a ton of stiff competition here. And look at this big sand waterfall wormhole. That's neat. And there's a dinky little magic minigame here on your first trip, so how about that? And you can do this! This game used to cost $50. It should have been more, because you can do this. Once again, not really a big fan of the Halloween Town world design in KH2. It's a Halloween hallway into a Christmas hallway. Did I say at the start that I wasn't going to complain? I lied about that. As I write, I just want to complain. Okay, like, the game is a lot better at other things. I agree with that. Please don't come for me. But listen, it's not all bad and boring. The shipping and receiving room in the toy factory is my pick for best area here. It's actually one of the most fun boss arenas in the game for my money, as gimmicky as it may be. It's got these very important dials and meters that measure Christmas cheer and joy capacity. It has Candy Prison, and thank God for this room because it's the best way to get that god-awful skateboarding trophy. Also, real quick, I literally had to ask my Discord server how the hell to activate the skateboarding game here. I was like, I remember skateboarding in this room, but none of these goddamn elves will ask me if I want to skateboard. And guys, it's so dumb. You have to go all the way back to the start of Christmas Town and talk to Locke of all people, who says, I'm going back to Santa's house, you want to come with me? Giving no indication that skateboarding would be involved, and then it just fades to black and plops you on the skateboard in the shipping room. It's so dumb. So, Pride Lands kinda sucks. It doesn't suck, it's just underwhelming. It's literally gray rocks except for the jungle and oasis, which are, you know, boring. So we're just going the iconic route here and picking Pride Rock, which, yeah, it's another boring room with gray rocks, but it's the boring gray rock. It's basically the Disney Statue of Liberty. It's a big monument that you can immediately associate with the source material, and it's also famously a gift from the French. And it's got lionesses walking around, so it at least feels kind of populated and alive. And they can watch in horror as you repeatedly run off the tip of Pride Rock, because what else is there to do for fun around here? And you can do this! This game used to cost $50, and it should have been more, because you can do this. Oh god, it's you again. Spooky cave? Spooky with an E, that is. I mean, three of the rooms here are just smaller retreads of what the KH1 book had to offer, and the other two options are Piglet and Kanga's house, which are functionally the same, so let's go to the dark, nefarious side of the Hundred Acre Wood. This dank, spooky-ass cave. This place is fraught with danger. More fun concussion rocks, slippery dippery ice, bees, not the bees! This place needs to be quarantined and closed off to the public. There's probably all sorts of dirty heffalumps and woozles roaming around in here. Perhaps even jagulars. Sorry for being racist. Also, did you know you can't even explore this room without playing the minigame? Sora's like, I better hear what everyone has to say first. Everyone as in just Kanga? Since when did you answer to Kanga, Sora? So for Space Paranoids, I went with the canyon, which I think is the most geographically varied and one of the most visually interesting rooms the world has to offer. Like, I don't know what really anything in this room or world is supposed to be, but it looks neat. I also like that you can see specific landmarks from the rest of the world from this room, like Red Tower and Blue Tower and Spotlight Red Beam Thing. Also, look at these blue pixel clouds. I didn't even notice them until I was touring the worlds for this video. Small details like that definitely give a room in a world a lot more personality, and unfortunately prior to this project, I was just running around trying to get from A to B and completely missed those. Maybe I need to stop and smell the digital roses more often. You can also skateboard in here, and that's pretty dang tubular. And the Space Paranoid skateboard is one of the coolest ones. IMO. And for our last stop in part 1, we've got The World That Never Was, which is loaded with tons of cool rooms and even cooler imagery. It's a linear bottom-to-top world, but I think it's fitting for what the end goal here is, which is the invasion and subsequent raising of the enemy's home base. And while conventional logic might point me towards an iconic room like the Memory Skyscraper or something really zany-looking like Ruin and Creation's Passage, I ended up going with neither. The room I chose is simple and not particularly physically imposing, but then again, same here. It's the result of your invasion and raising of the enemy's home base, the proof of existence. You know, the organization graveyard slash hotel hallway to everyone's bedrooms. I've discussed it before, but back in 2006, it definitely struck me as a bit surreal because it felt like the game was openly acknowledging that these characters were, like, dead. Now, we and maybe even Nomura didn't know at the time that they'd all be back one day without any flesh wounds or severe burns, but at the time it was like, shit, check out this murder collection. It's also just cool having this physical representation of everyone's rank, title, and weapon, except for Zexion's, of course, which I'm assuming was vandalized by Marluxia and Larxene. Forgot to give one of your characters a weapon and need more time to write that in? Just throw a brick on his virtual gravestone. Nobody will notice or theorize about it. But yeah, all in all, I chose it because of all the dead people in here. Sora sees dead people. Where have I heard that before? Hey, what's up? Feels like just a crazy amount of stuff happens in between each video, even though it's only like, you know, a week or two. Sponsorships are a thing. My sub count doubling, that happens sometimes. At the time of this recording of this outro, which is the day that I'll be uploading the video, we are like 20 or so away from 10,000 subscribers, which is, I need like a thesaurus for words for insane, crazy, unprecedented amount of dopamine for my brain. It's awesome. It's great, and I don't want to count my chickens before they hatch, but I think we're gonna get there within like the next couple of hours. So thank you guys so much. What's new here? Well, I figured after a couple of requests, both in live streams and on my Discord, and I might be overextending, but I am going to launch a Patreon. You know, the Ko-fi will stay and stick around for people who want to make, you know, one-time contributions to support the channel. But if you are, you know, so inclined, you can pledge a monthly amount and you will get access to additional content. I'll put the link up and you can check that out. There's three different tiers, all with some pretty cool benefits. It feels weird to ask people for money like during a global pandemic, but you know, if you are able to and you're in a comfortable enough spot to do that, I would obviously appreciate it so much. I want to go through a little bit of fan art again here. Tax P by Cherry, a little edit on the drawing that my sister did. We got Squires sent in this Platinum Presto art of Platinum Presto saying trans rights, as well I, trans rights. One of my Discord mods, Regular Roxas, did this Platinum Presto painting, very good. Got some Platinum Presto keyblades from GSMan243 and Vile. Love that the keychain on the first one is a copy of KH1, and the details on the one on the right here, it's crazy, and I love the silly little face. This one isn't strictly regular Pat related, but to keep my ego in check, here is a Kingdom Tilly's rendition of Final Mix Sora. Maybe I'll do one non-me related thing per video, but I you know, love me some KH1 FM, so here's that. Obviously part 2 is coming soon. I got a really fun idea for a March Caprice, by the way. Check out March Caprice, March Caprice KH on Twitter, MarchCaprice.com. If you're a Kingdom Hearts, you know, aspiring or current content creator, definitely check that out. It could be a good way to get your foot in the door, get some exposure. It's a big virtual internet showcase of Kingdom Hearts content. It's going to be really fun. That's March 27th. Follow me on Twitter, SubparPatsby, you know, tweeting away. Join the Discord. Man, there's so much stuff going on. I'm so excited. It's been a great month. You know, it just feels like since Christmas, I've just been like on a regular Pat roll. That's all I really do, and I love it, you know? I genuinely love doing this, and I love that you guys watch it. So, thanks again, and stay regular.